Well, I hope you're out there. Thank you for joining us. Welcome to this special Hyper Japan conversation with French film director Julien Faraut. And I'm delighted to have you here, Julien. Welcome. You're in Paris.
Good evening, everyone.
Hi there. And we're here to talk about The Witches of the Orient, which is your new documentary movie, which is, by the way, available for free for you all to watch. The links will be, I'm sure, will be available here and on the Hyper Japan website. It's a great documentary movie, literally just now out in cinemas and getting released and getting very, very good reviews, actually wherever it's gone, which is fantastic. And it's, of course, deliberately coinciding with the Olympics in Tokyo. This obviously was at least part of your plan, Julien, that the film might just happen to coincide. And I guess with the delay, you've had an extra year to gear up all the promotion and release of the movie.
Yeah, exactly. It's yeah. It's not a real happy coincidence, as you mentioned. It was our plan, but one year of postponing, yeah.
Yeah, right. But the story is really topical, of course, because we're in the Olympics right now. And it takes us back to 1964 when Tokyo was hosting the Games for the first time. But it takes us back even further because by the focus of the movie, the witches, in the words, the subject of the movie, are actually an amazing Japanese volleyball team. And we'll be discussing a bit about how that their story begins. But they have the exceptional triumph in Tokyo in 64 of winning that category in the Olympics. In fact, in that very year, volleyball was a brand new sport, the same way that this year, I think it's skateboarding, I think is the new sport this year, but back in 64, volleyball was obviously a sport, recognized, certainly played internationally, had its own world championships, but it was not in the Olympic arena yet. And so the double thing of a brand new sport and Tokyo hosting its Olympics and having such a major success sparked an extraordinary cultural event. So let's just start off with really how your interest in this subject began, and how did you first embark on the project? I mean, quite apart from hearing about these amazing lady athletes in Japan, how did you track them down if you were going to try and research more about them?
I came across to the witches' story through a film, through footage. I'm in charge of a film collection owned by the French Sports Institute in Paris. And approximately 12 or 15 years ago, a volleyball trainer came to me with two 60-millimeter film. And we watched the two reels, and I discovered the whole thing. I discovered the training session and of the witches, and I was really stunned by what I saw. The speed of their move, of their drills, the intensity of the training session.
Yeah.
But it also reminded me all of a sudden to the anime I used to watch when I was a kid.
Right, we need to touch on that because a lot of the audience may not be here for the volleyball, but they're definitely here for the anime.
Yeah.
Okay. So what was the, you were, as a kid, you watched on French TV, of course, you were watching what kind of anime, and the volleyball anime especially?
In 1987, the very first Japanese anime were broadcasted. And so the volleyball one was Atakayu. Mm-hmm. Which was renamed in France Jeanne et Serge, with two very French names.
And of course, you didn't for a moment believe it was French, did you? You knew it was Japanese.
I don't know. Maybe when I was a kid, I still don't know.
Right.
But so Jeanne Azuki was the main character. Uh-huh. Her name was Mila in Italy and in Germany.
Yes. Yes.
And Juana in Spain.
Wow. Not in English, notably. I mean, it didn't come out, certainly not in the UK. We got so little anime on our TV here. Did it go to America at all? I don't know if it did.
I don't think so. I don't know.
No. But it certainly it's in Europe.
Every Japanese anime came to Europe through Italy. with Silvio Berlusconi private TV channel.
Right.
Because we have in France La Cinq, which was a channel from this Berlusconi group. We have the first anime.
Right. So it comes through Italy and we have that to thank Berlusconi for. If not, well, thank you, Silvio. Grazie mille.
Jeanne et Serge, Attaque You was a real success very quickly. And the French broadcaster tried to broadcast also Attaque Number One under the name of Les Attaquantes in France. But Jeanne et Serge was too popular at that time, and the public just not welcomed this supposed to be a copy, but we didn't know back then that it was the opposite, because for sure Attaque You is a more recent spin-off of the very first Attaque Number One.
Maybe it was a bit more modern too, though. I mean there's a bit of a time gap, isn't there, between the two. Maybe the style looked a bit older, maybe. I don't know.
When I watched the two, I confess that I think the Attaque Number One is more classy, and Attaque You is more cheap, so to speak. And I really prefer now the Attaque Number One style and complexity.
Right, the original, 68, or 69 actually, right. So that was your exposure to it, but then you didn't know, obviously, at that stage about the connections with the real Olympic triumph. This you mentioned, was it 16mm movie you said you'd...
Yeah,
that's... I mean, that may go over people's heads, but I mean, my dad used to be a home movie maker, home movies, not just home movies, and he always preferred 16mm, and that is old-fashioned, you know, film, isn't it? Old-fashioned celluloid. The films he gave you, were they things he'd like filmed on the spot or off the TV or something? What were his sources for this footage of these amazing ladies?
So the first film was a technical film produced by the Olympic Japanese Committee. It was named Volleyball, and it just showed international players, and only one sequence was focused on the Japanese women team.
Right.
So it's the black and white I use I pick up some very short excerpt in the film.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the second reel, 60mm reel, was actually an episode of Attaque Number One.
On a 60mm film, right?
Yeah, it was really beautiful, the color, the animation.
Yeah, yeah.
So if I can recall it step by step, before I find out that there was a real inspiration, my first thought was, it's amazing how the footage and the anime was similar in terms of frame and image composition, and so I didn't know much about it, but I'm pretty sure that Shigeko Urano and the team that was in charge of the animation surely they watch footage and try to be inspired not only by the story but by the footage. And try to just give more power with the drawing. But I really like also in the use of my film to play with the two and to just reality and fiction.
Juxtapose the two.
Yeah, and play with the footage and the anime, the image.
This might be a good point, actually, Anna, who's kindly in the background from Hyper Japan. We've got a very nice little taster of how Julien intermixes the anime and the live action playing. Can we just see a little clip of that to give people a taster? That would be kind of you. even now, I think, for later. But the point about the you're investigating this material and realizing the two could be built together. Okay, you two are back to screen. What does that mean? So have we perhaps it's been shown?
Oh, okay.
Oh, sorry, we didn't see it, but that's okay. Well, there you saw it. Maybe we're talking over it. Forgive us if we were. Well, now you have a flavor, even if we didn't see it ourselves. We obviously, nobody knows what you've seen. This strikes me as being a very clever thing, not just because you're underlining how the real sport footage connects with the anime, but it also, of course, just is a practical thing, because actually you have, I think, a relative shortage of live, real photograph, filmed footage. And so actually to kind of make the film work, it also enables you to have longer sequences by having the anime inserted. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, it's true, totally true. When you have to make a film, you have to face many technical issues. And in my case, I work with footage. And so I found some materials, but they are not lasting very long sometimes. Yeah. And I have to tell the story of two long game. And the editing, the original editing was sometimes not very fair, not very, the rally was not, sometimes they just pick up an image that didn't belong to the rally. So I have to.
So you don't get an actual sense of the whole flow of the play.
Yeah.
Which is really what you want to be able to follow from one thing to the other. Yeah.
So I have decided to filling the blank, to add the anime to complete what the materials are missing.
Right, and it all comes from Arana Chikako's original attack number one. Is that's the one, isn't it? It all comes from that, exactly. Yeah. And the interesting, because I mean that of course began as a manga, by the way, as so many anime tend to do. They will begin. And I was looking this up, and it ran in 68 for 12 volumes altogether. There were 12 volumes of the manga, and within a year, very quickly, it was snapped up for turning into anime, and that ran for 2 years, 104 episodes. And there were 4 movies. I don't know whether you've seen those. Are the movies, presumably, are they made from the TV stuff?
Sign V, I know Sign V.
Okay. Is that new material, or is it the reworking, using the TV anime?
I thought you were talking about the Sign V was one of the very first drama in early 70s.
Right. As in live action drama.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. No, I was talking about the fact that there were movies made, I believe, spin-off movies made from.
Attack Number One was turned to a TV drama, I think.
Right. Oh, right.
Yeah.
You stuck to the contrast between the live action sports and then the anime. For the other material, you didn't want to have mixing other forms of live action with a live action drama in with it. That would be perhaps too confusing.
Yeah, maybe too much. And I really like the anime because the drawings, the texture of the image is quite different.
Yeah.
And I also choose to keep only on Attack Number One because it also creates kind of unity and. Yeah. Also, because this is really the one that was inspired by directly with the witches, and then I guess all the followers just take advantage of the success of Attack Number One.
Sure.
And I really like this idea of a long chain of inspiration.
Yeah. Because
Attack Number One was inspired by a true story, and they try to take advantage from this very popular story and players. Right. And then the others, Sign V and Attacker U more recently, just try to follow the path opened by Attack Number One.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have real players that was inspired by the anime. So So it's a long chain of inspiration.
I was seeing on this on an Italian fan site where they were reporting about the movie that again there are some famous players, women players there, aren't there? I've seen growing up with the anime. Yeah.
Her name is Francesca Piccinini.
Piccinini, yeah.
Yeah, she's one of the most valuable and best player. And she's Italian, and she told to the Italian press, I think it's the La Gazzetta del Sporto, that she began playing volleyball after watching the Mimi e la Nazionale della Pallavolo,
which is the Italian.
Pallavolo,
localized. Brilliant. So let's get back to the real ladies and the real story, because that's important for people to realize what they're going to be watching is their story, which is extraordinary in itself. Because these are quite young women, and their regimen, their daily regimen, is really tough. They have a factory job. The actual team they're playing for is a volleyball team run by a factory, and they have to do a good fair number of hours, at least about maybe 6 hours or 7 hours, something like that, on the factory floor doing their work. And then they have a lunch break, and then they train for hours in the afternoon, and then they have perhaps another break, and they train again till about like midnight or later. And they're sometimes only getting a few hours sleep before they have to wake up and start the 6 a.m. shift in the factory. I mean, these were young women, has to be said, I think in their 20s. But this is such a tough regimen. These ladies are still with us, almost all of them, I believe. And how were you able to reconnect with them now that they're obviously more mature? How were you able to contact them and then persuade them to be part of this film?
It took us almost 1 year to find them. We were in contact with someone from the French embassy that were in touch with people involved in the Tokyo 2020 Olympics.
Uh-huh.
And one of the main chief of the Tokyo hosting Olympic committee was also a former volleyball player. But not of the same. She doesn't belong to the same generation.
No.
She was in the Montreal 1976 team.
Mm-hmm.
So she was very helpful to for us to get the contact with one of the players.
Mm-hmm.
And then we just try to explain our aim, and it was not the very first interview request was very quite common for them, because the players are very familiar with press coverage and requests. But when we explained that my aim was to make a feature documentary film, it was not very common, and especially from someone that abroad, outside Japan. So they were surprised, and I think they were also proud to be in the middle of a feature documentary film.
Right, because they are they still famous in Japan? Have they been slightly forgotten, or are they still fated, still celebrated?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
NHK, the national TV broadcaster, is repeatedly every year made a short report on them and just celebrate this old triumph. But it's definitely in people's mind, and the Witches of the Orient, the name is really familiar for sure.
Right. I mean, you open with a really wonderful piece of old, really old, like 1930s, maybe something like that, black and white anime, really wonderful. Which has a kind of reference to the witch's nickname. It is, of course, a nickname because it suggests that they've got some kind of supernatural powers. Where does the name witches, who gave them that name in the first place?
The Witches of the Orient was given by the Soviet Union.
Right, so it wasn't a compliment. Is it a compliment, do you think?
Well, maybe. I guess it can... Yeah, we can say, we can tell it's a compliment. But it was also a bit touchy because the Soviet Union was their rival.
They were the world champions, weren't they? Yeah.
So the witches, the women of Japan, they travel. They have they had a tour through Europe, and they won 21 consecutive victories. And when they arrived in Moscow for the very last game, the Soviet Union press, I think it's the Pravda, it's Kasai's son, Captain Kasai, the captain of the team, that recalled this story in her autobiography. And she explained that the Pravda explained that a typhoon came from the Orient, but this typhoon will probably vanish and fade away here in Moscow, because here is the best team of the world.
Well, you'd expect that from Pravda, I guess.
Yeah, but so the Japanese they defeated the Soviet Union. So the day after that, the Pravda has to nickname them the Witches of the Orient.
I guess, in Russian folk tale and fairy tale, witches are not necessarily, they certainly are powerful and not necessarily always necessarily ugly or monstrous or anything like that. But there was obviously perhaps a suggestion that they weren't supernaturally endowed in some way, that they were to have done this. It must have upset the Russians to have lost a little bit.
Maybe the end of the witches, I think, is quite a compliment. But maybe from the Orient is more imperialistic and maybe more Russian type. Like I can't tell where Japan is on the map. So from the Orient, because
it's the otherness, the othering of the Japanese. Yeah, but that transition, of course, to becoming world champions was an extraordinary breakthrough. But to get there, the other crucial thing you covered in the film is the training by their trainer Daimatsu Hirofumi, who is really deserves a documentary in his own right. I think he seems to me to be you decided not to make too much attention to him, and meant quite rightly you get to know all the many of the older senior ladies who are still with us and who get their perspectives on it. But he is the kind of Svengali. He's described as a demon, in fact, for his training regimen. And some of the footage you've got of that is extraordinary. I think, do we have a training video that we've got an example of to show here? I can't remember if we do. Do we have one? Yes, we do. Anna, thank you. Best we could just slip that one in now, because we would like to get a flavor of just what it was like for this team to become, how you become the world and Olympic champions in volleyball. This is what they had to do.
Come my way. I'm gonna...
Great, we're back. Okay, well, there you are. I, of course, have seen the film a couple of times, but it is devastating. He's like a machine when he's bowling the balls at them, and they sometimes get quite badly injured. And there's a dynamic going on here. How would you describe the relationship here? What's going on that he's able to drive these young women to such extraordinary lengths?
So I deliberately choose not to focus too much on Daimetsu because he was also, he wrote many books. He was really popular. Mm-hmm. He had a brief political career.
Yeah, I saw.
But he was really a public people, someone that was very famous in Japan.
Mm.
And I really want, and also Kasai-san, the captain, was in charge of the public relation, you know. Mm-hmm. She talked for in the name of the other, on the behalf of the other. So I really want to give the opportunity to the player, to the remaining team, to talk about their journey.
They're not allowed to express themselves so much. I can see that's
So Daimetsu was a very interesting man. He has this special experience, traumatic experience in during the World War II.
Right.
And I remember I read in an article written by an American academic. He told that he discovered that Daimetsu suffered from humiliation in his prison of war camp. And I totally disagree with his explanation, and I think he was totally misunderstanding the story. So this academic explained that Daimetsu trained the women of Japan like this as kind of a revenge, because during the his prisoner of war experience, the British choose to give the lead of the camp to female officers, because it was much more humiliating for the Japanese. So this academic tried to explain that that's why. And so I really thought that it was too much a gender focused explanation, because I have to ask you two questions. If Daimetsu had trained a men team, do you think that he would train them more gently, more softly?
I don't think so.
And if Daimetsu suffered from male officer instead of female officer, do you think he would have trained the witches less harsh or less with less intensity? I don't think so. I think the intensity, how strong, how fast this type of training is really a Japanese custom and habit. When the Japanese, when they train in every sports, they has this attitude huge commitment and total. There is a taste of effort. So maybe for Westerners it could be impressive. I think it's really Japanese. We don't have to judge it and say that they are just savage and they work. And I thought that it was a misunderstanding, and that's why my aim was. Giving the players the opportunity to tell the story themselves.
Right. And then, how do they come across? They seem to actually really have liked him, seen him as a sort of father figure and respected him. And they also all seem to have been completely transformed by the experience. In terms of mentally and physically, I mean, the very fact that they are so fit to this day is very impressive, it seems to me.
Yeah, they are in very good shape, very healthy women, which is the best proof that this program, this training regime, right, was not traumatic and was not injuring.
Right.
They were, all the players were very grateful to this man. And we have, just to add something, that you can't force someone to become a high-level athlete. It's very difficult to win a gold medal, even with people that badly want it.
Oh, yes.
So what about pushing and forcing someone? It's impossible. You can't force someone to be the best players. So the players, they just choose to work with this trainer because they knew, they understood that he was the right person just to achieve their goals, their dreams.
So they completely trusted that in the training. Totally. Yeah. I mean, we've got the celebration today in the UK of Tom Daley, third time lucky, getting his gold in the synchronized men's diving today, which is thrilling for him. And again, I expect the pressure these athletes are under, especially in the Olympics, is extraordinary. And they rely so much on their trainers, don't they, to find their way through and to be able to do it. Trainer-player relationship is extremely important, quite clearly. Yeah. Let us touch on the impact of the crossing over, because one of the touching things about the real experiences of these women, which is fascinating, many of them still training, and there's one of them that does kind of gym training that I certainly couldn't do. And I mean, maybe you could, but it looks very, pretty tough. And she's still going down to the gym. Fantastic. I mean, you don't stop, do you? But also the crossover, there's a charming sequence that I'd like us to drop in if we can, Anna, which is the one where the anime seems to still be part of big culture, general public culture. As we know, anime and manga are massive. They're not just sort of a niche element of society in Japan. And there's a lovely sequence where the family is watching this classic anime together, and she has her children and grandchildren with her. She's got this whole generational thing, which I think really captures the impact of what they've done. That it does come back to them. It does begin in 1964 in Tokyo with their success. Everything has come as a result of what they did.
そうですよ、鬼の大末です、うん、それは他の人たちが見てる人たちだとか2軍の3軍で一生懸命やってる人たちが私たちの練習を見て、すごい練習してるねって、監督は鬼だねっていうのは言ってましたよ、みんな。はい、そうですか。
Okay, so I think that's a really charming family scene, and again, it's one of the high points to me of this movie. So coming up to date, I mean, these ladies are still feted, as you say, and well known, and now, of course, they're going to get known around the world, aren't they? Because this story's not really been in the kind of international sort of arena very much. It seems to me this film is really bringing the spotlight onto what they did, would you say?
Yeah. And it's also why I choose to make a film on it, because I think they deserve an international audience. And
yeah,
so it's totally true that maybe because of the manga and the anime are so popular, that was just hiding the source and the inspired the true story.
Yeah, I think so. A lot of people who will know the manga anime first will be fascinated to realize just where it all comes from and how it's, you know, deeply rooted in reality and in this great success. some of the other spin-offs, because I've got some images I wanted just to show, which I didn't do at the beginning. So Anna, I know you've got them lined up for me. Maybe we could start by showing the Viva Volleyball image, the Ganga page of artwork. Just to explain here, this is something where, just that, as you know, amongst the many, there are many others. And I don't think Ide Chike's Viva Volleyball was probably quite so big. I don't know if it was animated, but it was in Ribbon, which is one of the, you know, the big, big shoujo manga, girls manga magazines from 68 to 71. And here's some of the artwork. I got to meet Ide Chike, who is a wonderful lady. I met her in Kyoto back in 2017. And she's still working in manga. I found a room in her, we went to her home, and we found a room where there was her assistants working away on more pages while we were visiting. So she's still making new stuff. And this was one of the many immediate spin-offs from the whole success of Attack Number One. And the other image I wanted to show, if you could share the other one, Anna, please, is just that, this is just some context here, but this image obviously also resonated. This is another image from Mangasia, which was an exhibition I curated for the Barbican Center, which traveled to France, went to Le Lieu Unique in Nantes, the former Petit Lou biscuit factory, which is a fantastic building in Nantes. And over the summer, a very hot summer, in 2018, the exhibition was put on there. It traveled to Italy as well first, of course, because Italy was the right place to launch this exhibition. It's a big show, essentially, of artwork and printed material from manga, from Japan, but also from lots of other Asian things. And that was the graphic for that. And then the other thing I wanted to mention in terms of another predecessor, and I will come back to you, sorry, Julien, but just to get my images out of the way so I can show them to people, was this story I discovered only over this weekend. And I don't think you'd heard about this before, but in 1928, the Olympics were being held in Amsterdam. And we have an image, I think, of the photograph. Anna, if you can get that one up for us, please. It's of two lady athletes running, I think it was the 800 meters, I think was the length. And on the left there, you can see Hitomi Kinue, who was a very surprising entry from Japan. And she got a silver. She was the first Japanese woman to be in an Olympic game for a start. And then she was the first to win a medal. And she got an equal second. And she came basically tied with the lady with her. The other athlete, they both came second, absolutely, you know, tied, tiebreaker. So she got a silver medal. And what's wonderful is that character, so that real athlete, also spawned a manga. Because within a few months, this strip appeared. Tonoko, I think is the name of the character. It's basically just a kind of tomboy, naughty girl character who loves sport, loves jumping around, is basically full of energy. And this became a very successful early manga by Rakuten Kitazawa in the Jiji Manga manga magazine, essentially manga newspaper from the 1920 to 1928. There we are. Tonda Hanako was her name. And she's a brilliant character. Again, what you have here, it seems to me, in both cases is, you know, women athletes originally, of course, and then spinning off into manga and then also later anime, showing what they can do, showing that they actually can become, you know, they're not just going to be, they can take an active agency in their lives through sport. They demonstrate, I think, a great sort of heroic model for their readers. Would you agree with some of that?
You make my day with this. It's amazing. This story is amazing.
Isn't that interesting? It's kind of, you could do another film about that, perhaps. that lady athlete has an interesting story in herself, I think, especially as she apparently died only 3 years after, in 1931. So it's a short film, perhaps, but that crossover, I think, is very interesting, that there is that connection. Yeah.
Yeah. And we have, back in the 20s, sports were just increasing and start to be something bigger. And
in Japan, yes.
Yeah, and everywhere. In sports start to be more international, more played
exactly.
more people, not only the upper class people. But it's also the beginning of a massive cultural Hollywood was going bigger,
yeah.
and cinema, etc. And we had many connection with sports women and men and, mm. and cinema and all. For instance, mm. all the boxers, the fighters, the prize fighters, right. they all play in a act in a movie and
yes,
and
yes.
there was always this connection between sports and culture. In this case, manga mm. and. We had many examples that of this interweaved two fields that just try to get the best of the popularity of one achievement or one success on the screen. And I know that another very big figure, much more recent, but Tamura Tani, which is a very famous. Judo
right.
Made a wonderful manga, and I don't know if it was turned to an anime, but Tani also became a kind of a character, not only a real person, but a yeah. character in itself.
Exactly, yeah. It's as you said, the whole sporting genre, well, in manga, the superken, I think is the actual name for it, it reflects that as well, that sport was such an important part. Yeah.
And maybe further on yeah. this topic, Hollywood was the best way for the U.S. to spread their products, their culture. And I think
that in many ways, yes.
I don't know if Japan thought that the most important product to sell outside would be manga anime. And,
exactly, exactly. That's really what has captivated the world, hasn't it? And they have accepted that. I mean, certainly celebrated that. We have international manga competitions that the government's organizing. We've got the Embassy of Japan here in the UK has been running for 15 years now, a manga jinman competition. So there's, you know, there's definitely, they know this is what's brought so many people, young and old, to discover more about Japan. So yeah, and this movie is a wonderful window into that. That crossover between the two, I think, it's really, really, really a fascinating one. And I think it's also touching that we don't often get to see older women basically given a voice in whether it's TV or documentaries or whatever. I mean, these are remarkable women. And we won't have time for the clip, but one of them is shown in the film training the next generation of volleyball players, which I think is tremendous that she's still got the moves. I mean, she's not just sitting around. sitting down doing it, she's joining in with them. That I think is an inspiring message as well, that you can do something all your life. I think my question was really just to, as we need to wrap up fairly soon, I think now, was just for these women, this clearly was a high point in their lives. And the one thing I wondered is how they reflected back on it. And particularly, did they feel that nothing else since could have possibly equal it? In other words, is there a slight feeling that they've reached their pinnacle? Clearly, winning the Olympics is something pretty extraordinary in anyone's life. Well, I wondered what they had been doing since. I mean, some of them perhaps had been literally bringing up a family and bringing up and then having their own grandchildren. So did they have some reflection on that? That this was their high point. This was their zenith, if you like.
Yeah, for sure. It was the pinnacle, zenith you talk about, for sure. Mm. But maybe we can talk about, which I think is one of the most important legacy of the witches. Mm. When they quit and when they just stopped their high-level athletes' career, they missed a lot to play. And so the playing... And there is they still playing all together.
Oh, you didn't show us that, though, did you?
And when
really?
So people knew about it, and a TV program start to set up some games between the witches and amateur players.
Wow!
And this show was very popular in the 70s.
Cool.
And here is the big and very important legacy. Kasai-san, the captain, just explained this on her once again on her autobiography, and she said that before the Olympic Games, young girls and young grown-ups were allowed and able to play volleyball. But as soon as they get married, they have to stop and to stay at home. Mm-hmm. And after that, with the witches show, amateurs game, mm-hmm. they created some what they call Mama San League. Mm. For women of all the, at every age, more than 40, more than 50, more than 60, and now nowadays there is a huge competition, and Mama San League is very popular in, wow. in Japan. That's and not only on volleyball, we have also football, Mama San football, Mama San baseball, everything. So I think it's very important how they create this. Change of swift image. How you talk about older people that are not on the spotlight and they are not very they're not on commercial. They're not we're not showing them. We are hiding them, yeah. And they were very helpful to change the mentality. And so I think it's one of the most important legacy.
That's tremendous. Yes, that's equally important, I think. Tremendous. Now, you need to fix your poster, by the way, Julien, because it's come off the wall.
Probably a bit. All right, because you have a very nice one.
That shows you it's live from slightly hot. It's probably slightly warm there. But great, thank you very much. I don't know if we've got any, maybe someone wants to communicate and send any questions. I'm not sure that we have time for that now, as we've run to 50 minutes just coming up. So let me really encourage all of you listening, whether live or in recording, to check out Hyper Japan's link so that you can see Witches of the Orient, the movie for yourself. It's a fantastic documentary. It's got some great music, by the way, as well. And it's tremendously well edited and gripping. And touching and really, really excellent. And I'm sure we should also wish, of course, for this year's Japanese volleyball team, I'm not sure where they've got to in the Olympics, but they must be under a certain amount of pressure to try and do it again for the 2020 Olympics. Let's hope that the Japanese volleyball ladies team do follow in the witches' footsteps. Good. I think we shall wrap up unless perhaps somebody wants to intervene and let us know we've got some questions or anything that we would like to add to the discussion. I hope that's been of interest to all of you. Thank you very much indeed. And good luck, Julien, for the rest of the release of the film as it goes around the world. I hope it does extremely well for you.
Thank you so much, Paul, for your enthusiasm and kind words.
Surely.
I wish you the best to everyone, and see you next time, somewhere, sometime.
Exactly. Very best. Goodbye from Julien in France and from me, Paul, in London.
Bye.
Bye.